Okay, so thanks for coming to this roundtable. The general idea behind this roundtable is that I'm going to lay out some stuff we've done at Epic, and then I'm going to stop and say, hey, does anyone else want to share or discuss or talk about? And if you don't talk, I'll keep talking. So that's the threat, right? Thank you for Brandon, who's an analyst at UX, for being a lovely model here on this front image. Just a little bit about me to start with. I'm a UX researcher at Epic Games. I have a PhD in psychology. My name is Ben. I'm a New Zealander, and you can reach out to me in a lot of different ways. I'm often on the Games User Research Discord channel. If you don't know that that exists, it's where people working in games user research can come together and talk, share ideas. We talk about different research methodologies and stuff like that. So this is what I'm going to talk through today, and topics I hope that people will want to talk about. And the approach I'm taking with this roundtable is to try to get really to the very basic levels and talking about things like lab setup, recruitment, testing, because testing in VR is so new that I feel like we don't want to jump too far ahead in this point. So what have we done at Epic so far? So we've put a few things out in VR. The original one was this street demo, where it was just an experience of moving down a street and kind of things were in slow motion. You could look at things exploding and try and basically it was look how great Unreal looks like in VR. The other thing we've done is the VR editor for Unreal, which is where you can use Unreal Engine and you can actually build out your levels and build stuff completely in VR, so you can pick things up. And there were some interesting learnings when they were working on this, in terms of things like what they found is the most effective way to move around within a scene is to frame the movement and set up the movement as if you're moving the world around you rather than you moving within the world. And this made people feel more comfortable in the setting and more attached to the setting and less likely to feel ill. Similarly, if you were ever rotating the world, that's quite a cue for getting sick. They would put a grid down and put a horizon constantly in the distance, so you had something to focus on as you turned the world or turned an item around you to work on it. Mm. Now, Bullet Train is the game that we probably first did some formal UX testing on, and it was only a little bit because this was, again, kind of just a demo of where players would teleport around to fix spots within an environment and catch bullets and throw bullets back at opponents that were attacking them. And teleportation was a mechanic that was decided upon for this game because it avoids any feeling of movement or vection from the players, which can lead to sickness. But at this point, with Bullet Train, you were only teleporting to very set points. There'd be a point you could see, you could go to, you went there, and it automatically orientated you in a certain way. So it restricted player freedom in some way. So then on to our first full game that uses VR, and that's Robo Recall. Robo Recall is kind of a extension of Bullet Train. And this is a clip from a UX test, actually, where the person was reaching behind his shoulder to pull out a shotgun and grabbed the robot that had snuck up on him. And he kind of was surprised for a moment and then just calmly blew the robot's head off and threw the robot away. And me and the moderator that were in the room, we almost lost it laughing, which is a good thing about VR because they've got headsets on and they can't see your reaction to what's going on. But Robo Recall is a kind of fast-paced, arcade-y type game that's built on similar mechanics to Bullet Train. You can catch bullets, you can throw them back and interact with the world, but you can teleport freely around. So it's got this mechanic in it where you push forward on a stick and then you rotate the stick to change your orientation when you arrive at the end of the teleportation. And this has been a challenge in UX tests because it's not an intuitive thing. It's something that needs to be taught, because when people have a VR headset on, they just want to turn around. And if they do that with Oculus tracking, the tracking loses their tracking, and it's not necessarily what you want them to do. So Robo Recall, even though it's a very active environment, we kind of want you to plant your feet and then use the mechanic in the game to be very mobile and to be teleporting around the place. So when we were running tests on Robo Recall, the first thing we had to look at is our lab setup and how we're actually going to handle this. And we didn't do a lot of testing, so it's not something that was worth building a dedicated area to. So we had to look at how we could run it within our existing setup. The contrast is not great here, but our existing setup is essentially we have a long line of stations and we have a one-way mirror that people look through. And it's soundproofed, we can record what's going on, and we have individual stations setting up. So I want to demonstrate what we're doing before we can discuss what other people have done and talk about some certain points here. So this is a station set up ready to test Robo Recall. And it's in a corner of our room where there was the least things that people could bump into when they had a headset on their head, but was also in a good position for people to be able to view through the mirror behind. So there's some features here I want to point out. So this one over here, this is a fan, because it gets really hot when you've got a headset on, and some people would start feeling really uncomfortable. And if that was the case, we can turn on a fan to cool them down. And some people would want this and some people wouldn't. The other thing is external speakers and combined with a headset. So the headset's to keep the player immersed in the game. It's the way that it's supposed to be played. And the external speakers are for us, who's in the room, to actually be able to hear the same feedback that they can and be able to see that. This can actually be a problem to set up with Windows sometimes. Windows doesn't like two audio inputs, and sometimes you have to work out tricks of doing it. And we found you had to plug them both in, plug one out, plug the other one in, wait for a pop-up, quit out of that pop-up, and then they would both work. But you'll probably have to work out what works with your setup. Generally speaking, we have the normal setup of the two monitors, so that would just mirror what they were seeing. On the ground there, you see the two little dots that we would just put down with tape. And this was to give people an idea of, here's where you stand to start the experience. And it would also let us judge how much they were drifting off that and where we could put them back to if we wanted to center them. In the second image, this one here, you'll see there's a nice comfy chair. And this is basically the emergency chair. If they were feeling like they really needed to sit down, or they were going to fall over, or they were going to be sick, which actually only happened with one of our players, then this is where we'd put them. It was near the fan. We had water ready. We had everything ready and set up for them to go. And then the last thing I've got highlighted down here is just long cables. Because people move around a lot with a VR headset on, it is a standing experience like Robo Recall, which is very dramatic. We had people dropping to their knees and trying to roll from side to side, or jumping up and down. It's very interesting to see people, because of course the guns in the game have no recoil in them, but people would play and they'd pull out the shotgun and they'd be going like this every time they shot the gun, even though they didn't have to. It's a very immersive experience. And then the other thing in our lab setup is simply a way to clean the device between each player. It gets very sweaty, it gets very sticky, especially if they are jumping all over the place. And we would run these not only over the lenses, but over the entire unit, which does wear down the unit to do that, but it's worth it in terms of keeping everything nice for the next participant. So, two things we had there were our considerations of safety and consent. We really instructed people on what was going to happen, took them through everything, made sure that they were aware that at any point that they could stop. Also, I would make it clear to them that if they're getting off track and I feel like I need to intervene to stop them from hitting an object, because as you can see, we still did have objects that we could get in trouble with, that I would touch them very gently on the shoulder and move them aside. And I made sure I got their consent for me to be able to do that. And then communication is a problem we didn't necessarily overcome, which is when they've got headsets on and they've got this thing that's completely removed from you. So if we were going to do more UX testing with VR games in the future, which we may do, we've talked about maybe considering some way to put them on a VoIP server, or some way to communicate directly to them if we have to, without having to shout or ask them to take the headphones off. Shouting worked, but it wasn't the most elegant solution. So what I would like to hear here is if anybody's got anything they'd like to add about lab setup, or any questions about our lab setup, or concerns they might have about this particular area. Yeah?
Just one quick thing.
I think we've got to have the mic.
So one thing just to add quickly, I know you mentioned like wiping down the headset can like wear it down over time. Mm-hmm. We've purchased for both the Gear VR and for the Vive. There's plenty of like washable covers and things that you can use for like a quick replacement, and then you can just clean them without having to worry about damaging the headset with alcohols or other, you know, or whatever else you might put on there, harsh chemicals. So I recommend those.
All right, cool.
So I've done play testing. I own a Vive at home. The fan is actually also can be really helpful to orient the player, because if you've got a consistent stream of air in VR, you can feel that. That's an external stimuli that you can center yourself back to. So I know when I'm being an idiot playing like that game, I'll be like wandering around. I'm like, where in my room am I? Fan's on my butt. I know I need to turn around and I'm good.
Yeah, I think it's a really good point. It was one of the problems we had with Robo Recall, in that because it's so natural for people to turn around, they would do it. And then even with the game telling them to turn back and face the sensors, it was often hard for them to work out where that was.
Sorry, I have a couple of things with the PlayStation VR. So it uses LEDs on the headset, just picked up with the camera. So in that case, for us, it was annoying that we had a one-way mirror behind the players.
Right.
So we had to hide the one-way mirror basically and make sure. We're sometimes testing with five people at the same time, so making sure the cameras were not picking the wrong player, that kind of thing.
Right.
Another thing we did was change our swivel chairs we had in the lab. So we had like chairs with legs, that kind of thing. So people are more stable and in a more comfortable position as well.
Right, right.
So the basic things we did with the lab.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, in Robo Recall, of course, it's a standing experience, so we didn't necessarily have to deal with the seating. But I did see I think Steve had done a blog post about having to cover the one-way mirror up. And if anything, with the Oculus we were testing with, having the one-way mirror there maybe made the tracking better rather than had problems, in that people were able to actually turn and be facing it, and the tracking was still working. So it could be having such a reflective surface for the IR that the Vive uses, or the Oculus uses, was actually a benefit. We didn't see any tracking problems. So it maybe that's hardware specific, maybe it's our setup specific, but it's certainly not an issue we encountered. And I was surprised when I saw it. It makes sense that it could be an issue.
Yeah, it's a different thing. But I would argue that in your case, maybe it wasn't a good idea, because if you're at home, they won't have a mirror.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was only something that I thought about later of how well it was tracking. I did talk to the devs, and they felt that it was just tracking like that for them as well in a non-mirrored setting, so it's not something that came to mind until later. But I think it is something to consider. Did somebody else have something to say? Yeah, over here. Sorry.
So one of the things with orienting yourself that our team actually put into place in the game is when you would get too far one way or the other that you weren't able to be tracked, like a light grid wall would come up on that side. And so then they would know that they need to move away from that light grid wall.
Right. Yeah. So what Robo Recall initially had is when you turn away, a big like chevron would show up and it would point like this and it would say turn around in the middle of it. And what we found is that players were basically ignoring it because they were still able to shoot, they were still able to do everything they wanted, and it wasn't noticeably bad enough to be outside of the sensor range for them. And we solved that by recommending that it said turn around to face the sensors and look a little bit more like a warning. But we did something similar, and once it looked more dangerous, people were more quick to turn back around. So there needs to be an appropriate, I guess, bad warning to get them to react. Right. I guess that gets to the point of it being a barrier, which they really want to avoid.
A little bit more of a question than a comment. Our studio hasn't done any VR recruiting or anything like that yet, but did you have to pre-screen out anybody who has existing issues with motion sickness? Did you find that... Oh, hey, there we go. Should I just wait for this question then?
Yeah, I'm just about to move on to recruitment. Does anyone have anything to say about lab setup just to finish up before we move to there?
So I have sort of two questions. One, I believe you began to touch on was that I think your description here was mostly a sort of one-on-one situation. Mm-hmm. Were you finding yourself running in groups? Because of course, that's real helpful to get to an end at a reasonable pace.
Yeah.
And then the other one was, I've forgotten it. Lingering effects, right, in terms of length of play, mm-hmm. right? Because we've had people who make it through a standard time session and then actually quit out during the survey because mm-hmm. things linger, and there's a risk when you then put somebody in a car afterwards, yep. right? And how you're handling that.
Right. So the second part of your question, I'll talk about quickly in recruitment when we get up to that. But the first part, certainly we were only set up for one-on-one testing. It wasn't a high priority project to be testing. So maybe you can answer that better about testing with groups and what the challenges were there.
So in terms of lab setup, I guess. Yeah. So actually our lab, we can put 10 people in. But because it's been built kind of in a circular way, so this way we could see better everyone from our observation room. This meant we can have only 5 people because of the camera will overlap with PlayStation VR, so we can only test 5 people. Was that your question?
Yeah, sorry, we have to not talk like replacements. Okay, so things I worry about, vomit contagion. Things like that,
right?
There's a problem. So we can sit up to 19 people in our labs in any, well, we can run 60, but we have multiple labs, right? So normally we can batch process. This is great when you're testing flat screen stuff, but there's sort of a debate for us at the moment of whether, how many people we even want to be running at a given time, mm-hmm. given the level of risk, and given, the risk is that you're going to have to throw out the entire lab,
mm-hmm.
right? Because even if nobody else gets sick, you've sort of intervened with some of your comfort data on that. So I was just sort of curious. We're running we're running 6 people at a time is kind of the max that we've hit on. No real logic to that. Also trying to space people out as much as we can and that mm-hmm. kind of thing. And we tend to, we don't worry about mirrors because we have individual pods and we just have people in the room and things like that. So that was where I was asking about.
Okay.
That.
Yeah. From my experience with simulation sickness, both in VR and before when I was an academic and working with it, is one way that it differs strongly from motion sickness is that because it's unpleasant, people tell you about it really fast. So it hardly ever reaches the point where people throw up. In fact, in the literature, people say simulation sickness doesn't cause people to throw up, and that seems to be a methodological problem that people tend to pull out. That's not to say it doesn't happen. And if it is happening, it's something I'm going to talk about a little bit later, is the big problem I found to overcome is participant willingness, where they will power through feeling uncomfortable. And that means you need to be really vigilant for the signs of them becoming uncomfortable before they don't. You need to really stress when they come in, if you feel uncomfortable, let us know, it's no problem, you get paid still, it does not matter. But if you start to see them swaying, or their game performance is going off, or things like that, that can be really signs for you to stop because you just don't want them to reach that point.
Sure. Agree with all of that. I will mm-hmm. say, both from some of our experience with VR, but also, frankly, with just making people exercise and connect, people are very heroic in their efforts to complete things. So mm-hmm. that's been a challenge and a risk as you increase your N.
Yeah. So. Did you find a way to overcome it?
Largely what we've been doing are doing just check-ins. So one of the things that we're doing particularly, so we tend to be a little bit more sensitive to people when they're first coming in, we train all of our mods in certain behaviors to just watch for. This sometimes picks up on things, it sometimes picks up on other things. Mm-hmm. Like if you're frightened because you're in a very immersive experience, you can read as sickness. But the other thing about it is that we'll just do taps on people's shoulders to get a thumbs up, thumbs down. It's non-invasive. It's a, hey, I'm just checking in on you, that kind of thing. We also do automatic breaks at certain points and things like that, depending on whether we're testing a released product or a pre-release product, those mm-hmm. sorts of vary, which I assume gets into methods and all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. So anyway.
Yeah, I mean, that all sounds like it makes sense to me. Someone at the back there.
So it was interesting that you guys had fans in the lab. We just finished a study, 240 participants across 2 VR displays, and it was really looking at sickness. We use a pre-heel-toe test, pre-SSQ, which is simulation sickness questionnaire, and then the post-SSQ, post-heel-toe test. What we found was is that turning the fan on and off was a really good indicator of sickness, including vomiting, which mm-hmm. we did have a few participants vomit. But since ours was a sickness test, we had, you know, things in place to keep them there for an extended period of time.
Yeah.
So have you guys noticed anything that occurs in your lab when you have those fans off or on? I know you have them on for comfort.
Yeah, we typically don't start with them on unless the person wants them on right from the start. And we only had to turn them on for some people. It certainly makes sense that changes in temperature could make sickness worse. It makes other types of sickness or feeling uncomfortable worse. So it was largely based on comfort. And luckily for us, I think with Robo Recall, because it uses a teleportation mechanic, it was very comfortable for players. So I'm not sure it's a problem that we particularly had, but it's certainly something that could have come up. Okay. All right, I'll move on just to recruitment. Yeah. So repeated with the same participant? No, we didn't do any repeated sessions with the same participant, and people typically played for about 68 minutes. Mm-hmm. Because the goal of Robo Recall is kind of that very short, arcadey type experience. Yeah. All right, so for recruitment, what we did at Epic is we pretty much followed our usual recruitment pattern. We have our own database of people, and we added some screening questions around simulation sickness, around VR experience with different types of VR games and different types of VR headsets. Apart from that, what we did is we ran our waiver past our legal department to make sure our legal department was happy with the extra risks that come along, that could potentially come along with simulation sickness. The second point is a point that Ubisoft actually shared with me, which is to ask every player coming in for a contact person who was available to come and pick them up and drive them home. And in fact, we tended to suggest that it could be best when coming for a VR test to be dropped off and to be picked up rather than to drive yourself because of the risk that Deborah mentioned in terms of lingering effects. We did ask upfront about VR experience and simulation sickness. However, everyone with VR experience nowadays is an early adopter and they don't feel simulation sick. And then people who are not early adopters probably don't know that they get simulation sick because there's just not enough out there. And we did come to a big question if we were going to do this further is, do you want to recruit for simulation sickness? For us, it wasn't a priority because Robo Recall is aimed at a very hardcore early adopter population. But it could be something to consider for others. And one thing that could be worth discussing is a way to do this. So I've heard some discussions around this area is try and skew your population to have more women in it. And this is based on some data that's hard to work out if it's a biological difference or just a experience difference, that women seem slightly more likely to get simulation sick. And then another one can be to ask for motion sickness type stuff, even though motion sickness and simulation sickness is not the same. You can try and get people that way, but maybe other people have tips here. So does anybody have anything they'd like to say about recruitment? We found it was very similar to our normal recruitment. We just had to add some extra things and make sure our existing waiver covered it, which it did. No?
Okay, so I have a philosophical question here, which mm-hmm. is, are legal people really think that the way that you should ask questions are you pregnant? No, you can't come in. Conversely, another model that psychology likes to use is informed consent.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just curious where people landed on this, where it says, hey, there's going to be a risk to this. These factors are things that may increase this kind of thing. Mm-hmm. And this is all through recruiting, independent of any of the sort of what happens in the actual moment.
Right. So We did break from our usual recruit, which would be to not mention what they were going to play. We did mention you're playing VR to give people a chance to raise these type of things and get at that. So that's what we did ourselves. And Sony do the same. And yeah, James, you've got a question.
I guess just if none of our actual experts are going to provide answers, I can tell just from owning a Vive and basically parading all my friends and apparently most of their friends through my house to play the Vive. I can tell you the number of people that get simulation sickness, in my experience at least, which is a pretty small N, is actually really quite low. I'm on a Vive, so maybe it's different on the different hardware. So I'm curious for you guys, in terms of, I always pick kind of a couple games on the Vive that I use as like, here, try this. If you get sick playing this, you are done, because I don't want, you're in my house, I don't want you getting sick. If you can handle this, then we'll let you pick your choice from my library. So I'm wondering if you guys have any, like, when you bring people in, do you have them play a baseline experience to establish a baseline experience, or do you just shoot them right into the game you're testing?
Right. So this is something I was going to talk about later when we get up to simulation sickness, but I'll do it now. Certainly that is one approach you could do. It's what we used to do in academia with our driving simulator. We had a road that was specifically designed to have a lot of right-hand turns, like right-angle turns in it, which is a very strong indicator of simulation sickness if people are going to get it. We would drive them through that for about 10 minutes. And then if they wash out at that point, that's usually where they were going to go. It's not something we did on Robo Recall, again, because it was mainly targeted at a adopter market. And so we didn't have as much concern about that. But I'd like to hear if other people have done anything.
So I can tell you, at least as one example, on the Vive, there's a game called Incel VR. It's actually not a bad game, but it is a really good gut check game. Like, if you can survive that, I haven't found anything else that I can't do.
So I think that's great if you have an idea of where you're taking your VR and if you know you're going to do like a teleportation experience from mm-hmm. the beginning. But with my experience, my team didn't want to have to do a teleportation system. And so they were trying a lot of different things. And the point was to kind of see how many people did get sick. And so we were worried about making them sick ahead of time by having them play something else. So we just throw them into the game, see what would happen. And then we'd have a lot of A-B testing with different things that they were trying to see if one thing made them more sick or more comfortable. Ultimately, they had a comfort mode with teleportation implemented and a free motion mode. But I feel like when you're testing this sort of thing, it kind of depends on what your team is trying out with the VR. Mm-hmm. And I don't think there is one right answer.
Right. So you're just saying it depends on the research question, basically, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
How did you handle informed consent then? Because if you knew there was a good chance that they were going to get sick.
Oh, yeah. We had plenty of times where 100% of our participants got sick.
Okay. So did you tell them, like, how did you handle the informed
consent? We had a separate waiver for just VR that let them know of everything that could possibly happen. And if they were, like, pregnant or something, we didn't let them play. So we did a mix of both.
One thing I'm interested with that waiver, did you go over it verbally or did you just leave it up to them to read it?
I stressed to them the importance of it and some of the main points on it, but I did not read the entire thing to them. I let them read it, but mm-hmm. I made them aware of what it was and the main points on it that were most important for them to know.
Okay. There's one back here and...
What we did for one of the games that we were testing for kind of the initial experience to kind of try and gauge was we put them, it was a match game, but we put them in like a non-combat situation to just kind of let them explore and get familiar and kind of see how they would do with that. And then if it was okay, we would ask them, do you want to, you know, keep playing? Do you want to move on where it was more actual fighting?
I think that's completely valid to do that if your question is not going to be hurt by it, which obviously your one would have been.
So I have the fortunate experience to work with the Mayo Clinic and Dr. Kennedy, who invented the SSQ in our research. And there's two ways I've seen the pregnancy tests go. I've seen experiments where women are forced to take the pregnancy test to participate, and if they don't, they still get compensated because there's a risk that they don't know they're pregnant, and they do the test, and then something happens, and then a lawsuit ensues. But I've also seen people say, well, I don't want to be invasive to someone's right to privacy, so we'll just ask them 3-4 times, are you pregnant? Are you sure you're pregnant? Are you sure you're not pregnant, et cetera, and go from there. But as far as measuring them before they come in, there is a motion history questionnaire. It's pretty useful. I'm pretty sure you probably, or some people in here use that. And then the SSQ. Between the two of them, I think the motion history questionnaire takes about 5 minutes to fill out. And you can eliminate people based on that. And then the SSQ has a baseline of symptoms that if they have those, then they're sick before they come in, like they had the flu or a cold, then you can eliminate them. But I think it's also a good one to sort of use as a measure to keep them around afterwards. If mm-hmm. their symptoms increase, then you can say, okay, yeah, we're going to keep you here for, you know, at least an hour or two, and then do a 24-hour follow-up call. But the pregnancy one, I've seen it go both ways. Whereas, like, if you're in the medical industry and you're doing something in VR, yeah, they force you to do the pregnancy test. But if you're in academia or a game company, usually the lawyers are like risk adverse and they want to go the opposite way because of privacy.
Okay, thank you.
Hey, I'm going to ask the thing that I hope at least more than me is thinking, like, are we supposed to check if people are pregnant? Oh, sure. No, that's not what I mean. And I mean, it definitely, you know, I didn't get into game science to stick people with things. So, you know, but what I'm curious about is there something in the VR literature where this is a problem? Like, I mean, I'm sorry, this is a pure ignorance question. I mean, should we be screening people out if they're super pregnant? Is that... I mean, like, so you know, come on, you're like very pregnant. You know.
So you're potentially making people sick. And that's what was going to be one of my end questions, is this is not something we deal with in games, which is in a lot of cases is a potentially very negative physiological outcome that, as Deborah said, can last for like 24 hours afterwards or longer. And when it comes down to it, it really is going to have to be something that you decide ethically and that you talk to your legal department about.
I suppose to some extent this is true of like the epileptic response too, though, right? Like, I mean, and I
sure, just, but it's I don't think it's as common.
Sure, absolutely. Okay, thanks.
I haven't seen anything clear other than the falling over thing, but you were nodding back there. Have you seen anything that's particularly very strongly physiological? No? Yeah. No? I thought it was you. Yeah?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, from obviously pregnancy tests, I mean, it's expensive and it's invasive, and medical people would usually administer it. Doctors, Mayo Clinic does that. But yeah, it's all about legal. If they fall over and there's any complications, it will be traced back to that, if not something else, and there will be a lawsuit. So you have to be extremely careful. And when I say careful, I would suggest that no pregnant women in VR studies, if there's a good chance of sickness and falling over and disorientation and things of that nature. But I mean, to each their own, I suppose, that people, I don't see why you would want to go the other route, but I do understand the over sort of the double standard that we have for certain groups of people, right? And that could go that way as well.
Flat out, you don't want people to fall over. It doesn't matter if they're pregnant or not. I understand being more sensitive, especially in a country that sues a lot, but you don't want people to fall over.
Yeah, just to provide some quick clarification. So I just had to redo my human subjects training. So this is really fresh in my mind. The Office for Human Research Protections of the U.S. national government actually classifies pregnant women as a protected research population. So I think that's where a lot of this comes from, mm-hmm. right? So that's why it's like a odd thing, because they have special protections under U.S. law.
Okay,
cool. Thank you.
All right, let's move on into testing a little bit, which is actually... We talked about some of this already, but actually running the test. The big questions we had was fit, finish, and calibration. This was making sure that the moderators who were showing the people that were coming in were showing them the right way of putting the headset on, because at least with the Oculus, if you don't pull it all the way down to the back, that greatly increases the risk of simulation sickness and people feeling uncomfortable. And with new players who never encountered it before, it could be a problem with them over tightening or anything like that. So it was really important for us to get up to the point that we understood step by step what the correct calibration is here and made sure it was being implemented. The questions we had is how much introduction to give, because we don't want to bias our data too much, but we also want them to be informed and we want them to be aware of what's coming up. So we erred more on the over introduction compared to what we would do with other games testing. And then this question that James already raised and we discussed about acclimatization period, whether we wanted them to go through some kind of base level setup or not. And for us, we decided it wasn't worth it with the timing that we had and with the population we were getting in. So has anybody else got anything they'd like to add here about what were the fundamental methodology changes you felt you had to make once the test was actually running that we haven't already discussed? If there's nothing... Oh, yeah, there we go.
VR research, so I'm curious about this. Inside of testing, do you have to think about, for lack of a better word, like wow factor? Like if you're doing testing experience of a VR game and someone puts on, like, wow, this is amazing, I've never done anything like this before, I think that would impact your findings? And is that built into like acclimatization or something like that?
I mean, certainly you could associate with that. Again, with our experience, we were getting adopters already, so that wow factor was largely not important. But also, because it's still early, that wow factor is going to exist anyway in the real world. So we weren't overly concerned with it, but I do think it's if it was something that was a problem, that an acclimatization period could help with as well. Yeah.
Okay.
So colleagues of mine were doing the PlayStation VR Star Wars Battlefront VR experience, and in that experience, you start off sitting in the pile in the cockpit of an X-wing fighter, and we definitely had that wow factor where our researchers were just like, okay, don't even bother trying to get them to do anything for a couple minutes, because people immediately sat down and they were like, let's try and flip buttons and switches and like press everything and look around and stuff. So we couldn't immediately like, okay, start playing the game, like start flying and fighting stuff. We had to let them just like sit there and be like, oh wow, this is super cool, I'm in an X-wing, and then let them get to the test. So
right,
it was definitely something we weren't sure would happen. It definitely did.
And that's an interesting point to make, and it's something probably I didn't think about with Robo Recall as well, is you may get to the point where your game actually has an acclimatization period at the start. At the start of Robo Recall, you load in and you're in a very safe environment, you're in a lobby and you look around and you're taught the very basics of movement in a low stress environment where there's not a lot going on. And this may have actually helped been this kind of test period for us where, you know, people would be looking at their hands and doing thumbs ups and things like this while they're just waiting in a kind of loading elevator and they don't really have much to do. Who's pushing it?
So in our experience, the wow factor for sure exists, but it exists pretty universally. So your game isn't going to be any different in that respect. And then one thing that we would try to do was to tease out the VR-ness versus the gameplay. So we would take breaks at specific times where they would take off the headset and they would talk to us. And, you know, we try to ask, you know, what are your likes, what are your dislikes? And then you can kind of, you know, if they're talking about the VR and how cool it is and the visuals and all that, and then you can kind of like steer the conversation towards the actual gameplay. What do you think about, you know, the specific characters or weapons or whatever, to try and, you know, separate that out. And, you know, some people would give us, say, like, oh, like, well, the VR is a 10, but the gameplay, it's a 5. And then you'd, you know, get them to talk about that a little bit more, but you have to tease it out.
Okay. All right. We've already talked a bit about this next part, but let's talk about simulation sickness dedicated to see if there's something else that wants to come up. I've given a whole talk on simulation sickness, so I'm just going to quickly go over what I generally thought to be some of the primary causes for it. So vection or a feeling of motion is a primary cause in terms of feeling sick. Unfortunately, it's also a trade-off with immersion. Latency and frame rate are really vital. So in UX, we can be used to and have a tolerance for broken builds. But if the build is got latency or frame rate problems, you maybe not need to not have that tolerance when it comes to VR. But in most cases, your developers will understand that because they also know that they can't have that tolerance for themselves for testing the game. Make sure the camera movement is appropriate and user controlled. If you take away camera movement from people, it's a good way to make them sick. Think about your hardware. This is, I already talked about it with the calibration. Playtesting is, of course, we should be doing it in general and also for simulation sickness. And if you can do calibration and design your game so it can have pauses in it, this can help reduce simulation sickness. So in terms of questions we had, scales have already been mentioned. There are several scales out there that are scientifically validated that you can use. In my experience, working with them has been mixed in terms of their real usefulness. In a very small sample size environment, they can be difficult to use. And if I've personally found, this may not be the best approach, but I've personally found if I can build trust with the participant, they're going to tell me the information I need. And I don't need the extra scientific rigor of the scale to know where it is on a number. But again, this is only in small scale testing. If it was larger, that might be much more useful. And that comes to the idea of numbers. If you are looking at simulation sickness and you're focusing on it, then you probably need big numbers. Unless you're doing things to intentionally make people sick, simulation sickness is a problem, but it's a minority problem. Unless you do certain things, you break the rules, like you have frame rate problems or you do activities that are known to make people sick. I already mentioned it, but one big thing I found both with Robo Recall and my past working with driving simulators is participant willingness is a really hard thing and a thing you need to look out for, because people are excited, they want to play the game, they want to get the money, they want to please you, they usually feel like they're in a power of being a submissive person to you because you're an important experimenter, and they don't want to give up. In the past with driving simulators, I've had somebody turning, he was Indian, but he turned white and he was driving at 5 kilometers an hour in the simulator. I'm like, hey, we can stop. And he's like, no, like he just really, really wanted to go. And it, like, basically what I did is I waited for him to get to a stop sign. And then I said like, oh great, we're done with the experiment now. Thank you very much. And treated him as if he wasn't failing out, because also it can be an ego thing for some people. And there's various ways you can get around it. The strongest way I found is just to be really upfront and make sure you get this informed consent and that you know what the signs are to look out for. In terms of the role of user research, we're obviously putting people into a situation where they can get sick, so we need to think about that. And one of the interesting issues that came up that hadn't really popped into my mind until we started to set this up was the problem of observer sickness. If an observer is watching the screen up top and seeing a head movement that's not their own head movement and is a bit distorted, some people feel sick from that. So you need to make sure that that's not gonna be the case with your observers and give them time to acclimatize if it is gonna be the case, or use different observers if it is. It's difficult to get around that. So has anyone else found anything here with simulation sickness that they'd like to share, or if they disagree with some of these points? Or have we already discussed this?
I'm just curious if the role of fatigue plays comes into play with simulation sickness.
Sure. According to the research, as far as I know, if you're tired, if you're already feeling run down, then you're more likely to also feel simulation sick. Would you agree? Okay. Yeah. It's going to depend on the experience, and it's going to depend on what they were doing before they came in, which of course you can't necessarily control. But generally the guideline for simulation experiences is support short play. You don't necessarily have to require it, but consider how the game, if the person takes the headset off or wants out, does it just automatically pause? Do they lose progress? These kind of things that you can think about from normal game design to support short play 100% apply to VR. And I don't know if there's a set guideline for don't let them play more than an hour or whatever it might be, but just make sure you do support the ability for them to bail out or to maintain short play sessions. And that can be through your game mechanics, or it can be through checkpointing systems or automatic pauses or whatever it might be.
I would say I totally agree that frame rate is what I found is the biggest influencing factor. And a study that we did pretty recently was late in development, as we're prepping, got a build and realized it had horrible frame rate, but the dev team didn't notice because they became so accustomed. So you can't always rely on your dev teams. And then the other thing, you know, diving a little bit deeper as we're getting, you know, rejecting that build and asking for another, is that frame rate was not universally good across the build. And that was something that was really important to know as well. So just like for me, that's something that was really important, and just to pay attention and dive as deep as you can on frame rate.
Yeah, that's a really important point, because the frame rate not only has to be high, it has to be constant, because a significant drops up and down in frame rate are really bad, as you say. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we actually had a similar situation with one of the builds of Robo Recall we had, where if the game was at night, it had frame rate problems, and if it was during the day, it didn't, and we had to make sure that people were playing in day settings and be aware of that, for sure.
So I have a two-part question, because as a former academic, I have to hog the microphone. One, when participants do get sick, do we have a system for recording and storing that information? Like what was happening at the time? Bug testing, if you like. You know, when we have a tragic software error, we keep a stack dump of everything that was happening that caused it. And if we have those kinds of things, are we keeping them? And I guess the second part of that is anybody, and I mean anybody in here, doing studies in their studios to purposefully elicit this kind of stuff to try to keep those sort of things on hand?
Yeah, a few people have said they have, so I'll let them answer that, because the one time we had someone get sick, it was because the headset wasn't on their head properly, and that was what caused it. So it wasn't something we necessarily had to be too concerned about, but other people obviously have had different experiences. So
we weren't actually trying to make people sick.
But you were trying out different motion, which is...
Yes, but our team was trying to overcome a problem in VR, in that you can't really do free motion. And they were trying new techniques to make people not sick when you're doing free motion. Unfortunately, a lot of their techniques did not work and actually made people more sick. And those are the kinds of things we recorded, is what made them more sick, what made them less sick of the new techniques they were trying to do. But the goal was never to make them sick. The goal was actually to give them the experience they wanted in the way that they wanted, without having to implement these sort of fixes that a lot of other games, and we eventually had to put in a comfort mode with those fixes as well, because they couldn't solve it. But when you are trying to solve those kinds of things, I think you will see an increase in the amount of people who get sick when you're doing those sorts of tests.
Yeah, and that's certainly a good point. And as a hint in terms of ways that you can suggest to developers if this is happening, obviously teleportation is a way, but some developers are increasingly resistant to teleportation because they feel like it's cheating. I've heard developers directly say that. One thing I have seen some developers do is field of view fading. which is, you tried it? Yeah. Which is, as people move, you basically make the field of view come in and become more like a tunnel. And as they stop moving, it fades back out. And it's kind of effective. Players don't notice it too much. It's a bit immersion breaking, but the idea is you're reducing those movement signals at the edge of vision that cause vection. Did it work out for you or not so bit much?
There is a bit in our free motion of that sort of thing, but the amount of tunneling that I've had to do to
it's a lot.
In the SSQ boundaries was so much that it was just as immersion breaking as a teleportation, and the teleportation had a better effect.
Right. Yeah, and I've certainly found when I've tried VR headsets with the funneling, and they do have to take it down very small, you're right, is it pretty much nearly completely knocks out all sense of motion, which is kind of against the point of walking around if you don't feel like you're doing it. But yeah.
So just one quick point about observer sickness. I ran research on Mirror's Edge Catalyst, which is a first-person runner, basically. And people are running up on walls, and then they jump off the walls, and they land on the ground, and they do a front roll, and the entire camera spins the world. We had very, very, very few players get sick, but watching as a researcher or as our moderators watching that got really motion sick from watching it. So just one thing to be aware of is if you're watching on a second screen and you're getting sick, it doesn't mean your participant is. They might be completely fine.
Yeah.
But watching it for some reason, I don't know the science. I'll let smarter people talk about that, but it was way worse for me than it was for them.
And the key thing there is this one, this make camera movement appropriate and user controlled. It's the same as in motion sickness, where often people who can feel motion sick or car sick, they don't feel car sick if they drive. Because you're in control, you're making the movements, it lets you anticipate what's going to happen. But when you're not, it's worse. All right, I'm not sure how much time we've got.
Like 1 minute.
Like 1 minute. Yeah. So I want to just leave off with these things. We're testing a product that can potentially harm a user. It's not something we typically do. And I mean simulation sickness physiologically, but I also want to point out there's a potential risk here psychologically. We're doing an experience that's much more engaging, much more feels like you're actually there. And in driving simulators, I've seen people put up their arms and scream. I've seen people reporting long-lasting post-traumatic symptoms from simulations. And this is something we need to consider working in VR. We need to think about accessibility in VR. VR is a great opportunity for accessibility, but is it something we're considering? How can the existing rules we have about UI be applied to VR? And teaching issues is something that came up in Robo Recall, in terms of we're often used to in video games having the luxury of being able to pause or control the player or control where they're looking and have a little bit of control when we need it for teaching. And you do not have that in VR in a lot of cases. You can do some things, right? It's not completely gone. So in Robo Recall, we could take away their guns if we didn't want them to use their guns. And we could do certain things, but we can't take away camera control from them necessarily.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So we'll leave up on that. Thank you very much. It's been a very interesting discussion, and please do continue it.